Hi everyone, I'm going to talk about one of my big loves, horses. The reason I want to make a video about horses today is there's been a lot of discussion about horse welfare. And I noticed that there is a difference between people, what they consider horse welfare. And this is very interesting to see, so I wanted to dive into it and give you a little bit of my opinion. A lot has changed for me over the past 7 years. One of the things was that I now look different at how to treat and ride horses. I have a court case with my horse U2. This is him. And I'm not going to talk about my case because it's in front of a judge. The appeal will be in May 2020. So a judge is going to look at it, or actually three judges are going to look at it, and they will let us know what they think. So I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, just like everybody else can do, about the general horse welfare, especially in competitions. About a century ago, people started using horses for different purposes. Before, it was for to work on the land or to get from one place to another. And we saw that it changed. Competition became part of it. Even Olympics were involved. And competitions have become much more important. A lot is at stake. Everybody just is hoping to win a medal or win a prize. Usually when there's a competition involved or money involved, that is usually more important than horse welfare. With the improvement of dressage and jumping over the past years, you can also see that winning has become more important than what is maybe the best for the horse. Especially the Netherlands is one of the biggest export countries of horses. And a lot of people don't know that. They think it's all about tulips and it's all about cheese. But actually, a lot of people from all over the world, they fly to the Netherlands to learn to ride or buy an expensive horse. So it's very important on the economic level of the Netherlands. Last week, an article came out in the Dutch newspaper Parool. And this was regarding jumping Amsterdam. Amsterdam has a policy or a law now in place that says that there are no events allowed that are questionable for the well-being of the animal. So the woman that wrote this article for Parool, she was saying that there has been a lot of scientific research that things like the bit and the spurs cause damage to the horse or injuries, and a lot of horses are suffering. So why is Amsterdam actually sponsoring Jumping Amsterdam? She was basically putting in this article these facts out that Amsterdam is sponsoring this event that is against their own law. I always loved horses and dressage, and I always liked competing. I even competed myself on a pretty decent level, you know, where the horse has to do flying changes. And I was so excited and happy when my horse and I were a team and he could do it. But due to my work and living in New York City, I couldn't do it anymore, but I was still involved on a very high level in dressage. When I read the article in Parool, I was like, there's a lot of honesty and truth to it. But what you see happening is that people like Olympic champion Ankie van Grunsven comes out to promote the Jumping Amsterdam and the equestrian sports. And she only said, as a response, like, we should bring out more positive message. The other people, the other side, they're saying horse riding is bad for a horse anyway, so we should all just quit horse riding. So it's either the people that are the people riding horses and competing on a high level, or even in the lower levels, that say we're doing everything fine. And then we have other people that are saying horse riding is cruel and we should stop it immediately. But there's a middle ground. There's a lot of things that can be done to improve the horse sports and equestrian sports. And in any part of life, you have to keep questioning yourself. You cannot be complacent. You learn new things. Everything you learn throughout life, you should be working with it and make things better. Especially when you work with animals, you have to keep educating yourself and getting better. When research comes out that says that it's not in the best interest of the horse, you should take it and work with it. And what I notice in the equestrian sports is that the riders and trainers want to just go on as they are doing and they think they're already doing it really well. And that's why the other side becomes more aggressive, because they see the suffering of the horses. I would advise the people in equestrian sports to just step by step improve the things that are not going well. There's been a lot of discussion about the training methods that obviously win Olympic medals or prizes, but are not really the way the FEI, which is the Federation of the Equestrian Sports, they have rules and laws and regulations, and the way that people ride in competitions these days is not according to the FEI rules. And it slowly has changed that way. People are questioning why in dressage are people not riding according to the FEI laws or regulations. And why, for instance, is it not allowed to ride without a bit on a FEI level? Because they have to have a bit. Well, maybe it's much better for a horse and it shows horsemanship if you can actually ride without a bit. And the last years that I rode years ago, my oldest horse that unfortunately passed away, Key West, we rode him bitless. He was great. And I think it has to do with confidence of the rider that you dare to ride a horse bitless, but it is very much possible. It's time for the equestrian sports to evolve. People that don't know anything about horses, they maybe don't see that the bit is too tight in the mouth of a horse. People do see when a horse dies on a track in racing that that's bad. The damage to horses in dressage and jumping is usually only seen after weeks and months and years. The training methods have evolved. The horse welfare has not evolved on the same level. So the competing became much more lucrative, more money and more prestige, while the horse welfare, what's really good for a horse, that hasn't gotten that much attention. And we also have to talk about how do we keep our horses? Is it okay for them to be in a stable 23 hours a day? Or maybe it's better for all horses that they have to be stabled in a bigger stable, or maybe 24 hours a day outside that they can walk in whenever they want to. I think the problem is that these two parties that do not agree at all, but they do say they love horses, is that they have a different opinion on what is horse welfare. One side thinks having golden knobs on the doors of a stable is horse welfare, and they have a clean bed and they are washed every day. And others say a horse needs to be outside. It needs to be with his friends. It cannot be in solitary confinement. A horse in a stable 24 hours a day or 23 hours a day is really bad for the health. And what I think is that a horse doesn't have a voice. If a horse had a voice and if it was in pain, it would have screamed and we would have known. But unfortunately, they cannot make sounds like that. So we have to really look closely at their eyes, at their body language, their tail, just the muscles, the muscle tone, to see if a horse is feeling well or not. I think also another problem is that people think, oh, a horse that doesn't feel happy doesn't want to do it. A horse is a prey animal. This means that in nature, they will try to disguise any pain or discomfort to make sure that they're not being hunted down by some lion or other animal. So they will hide and they will try to just go on with their life to just not be attacked by this animal. It's like sometimes a life or death situation for them. This is where the term learned helplessness comes in. There are many horses that just gave up and like, this is my life. I have to do this every day and there's nothing I can do. If I don't listen, I'm gonna be whipped. If I don't listen, they're gonna kick me with spurs. This whole idea that a horse, when it doesn't feel well, will just throw you off and that's it, is just BS, because most horses that are smart horses, they will continue going on until the damage is so great, because they don't want to be hunted down. That's how their natural instinct comes in. And the learned helplessness is very tough for many horses. And if you have people that do not read the signs, that's how you get a lot of horses with all these other ailments. And then they usually treat the result, like maybe their back aches or they have pain somewhere, instead of seeing what the cause is of the discomfort. And a lot of time it's just the riding. I think most people like me just want more welfare in sports, and that everything is being according to the FEI rules. It's much harder to train a horse to that level. It takes many more years to build that trust. So a lot of people don't want to invest that time. They just want to go to competitions and they want to win prizes. In the Netherlands, it's illegal now to use shock and prong collars on dogs in training because they found that it was not in the best interest of the animal. It was painful and it gave the dog discomfort. Because it gives discomfort to the dog, they were thinking maybe only professionals can use it. But they also found that even in professional hands, it was not in the best interest of the dog. So they made it all illegal. This can happen to the horses too, because certain things that people use on horses are, even with professionals, are not that friendly or good for the horses. So why wouldn't they make a law for that as well? I think that everybody should just listen to the issues that are being brought to the table when it comes to horse welfare. If there is science that says that a certain thing or a certain training method is not good for a horse, then take it to heart and do something with it. Because if you love horses, you will always want to evolve and get better. I will talk more in the future about horses because I just absolutely love them. My horses are doing well under the circumstances. I gave them exactly what they need. I hope that this video helped some people a little more this perspective, that it's not all about let's hide everything and bring out a positive message, but also there's reality to these claims and people need to take it seriously because it's the well-being of our horses. And if they don't do anything about it, maybe equestrian sports will eventually just leave the Olympics. So it's all in all these equestrian riders' hands, how they are going to ride and how are they going to treat their horses, that will determine the future of equestrian sports. See you next time. Bye bye.